Welcome to Harlow on Healthcare. I'm David Harlow, and I invite you to join me by my virtual hearth as I sit down with healthcare leaders to discuss building the future of healthcare. Today, my guest is Keith Hovan, President and CEO of Southcoast Health System, which includes Charlton Memorial, St. Luke's, and Toby Hospitals in southeastern Massachusetts, along with their affiliated physician group, Visiting Nurse Association, and Accountable Care Organization. He has been active in healthcare and civic organizations on the local, state, and national levels as well. Welcome, Keith, and thanks for joining us.
Pleasure to be here, David.
So, Keith, in an earlier, perhaps simpler age, the community hospital was often seen as the key healthcare institution on the landscape, and hospitals in general were seen as perhaps more central to the delivery of care. How, from your perspective, has that landscape changed over time, and how has South Coast changed, either in reaction to changes around it or perhaps in anticipation of some of these environmental changes?
David, you are indeed correct. It had always been that hospitals were the major focal point of care in any given community. And what we've seen over time is a true evolution of the healthcare system to one that is much more focused on community, realizing that hospitals will always have a role to play as it relates to the provision of care to the sickest of patients. But in a real system of care, the focus should be on health promotion and the prevention of illness. So we've seen it in our system, a movement from the inpatient hospital to the community, bringing more care to where people live and work every day, trying to have an impact on what we refer to as the social determinants of healthcare, those determinants that really create barriers to patients receiving preventative care. That could mean issues related to transportation, socioeconomic challenges, challenges getting good and healthy food. As providers now, we have to be concerned about all those things that impact an individual's ability to really remain healthy.
So I've been involved in conversations in person and online about social determinants of health. And in particular, recently, one conversation I was in led to the question, well, gee, yes, of course, we need to do all of this. And the question is, who pays? Well, where's the money coming from? We don't necessarily or shouldn't necessarily expect a community hospital system to be paying for food, to be paying for housing. We've seen in some parts of the country, health insurance companies have started to get into the housing business one way or another, and they feel that it'll work out in the end if, in fact, housing security is going to improve healthcare status, then healthcare services will cost that insurance company less in the long run. But that seems to be a significant long-term investment, perhaps not one that a community hospital system may be able to make. So what's your connection to the delivery of those services, and how does the financing of those services work from your perspective?
Many of the mechanisms to pay for addressing social determinants of health have not really matured in such a manner that hospitals or healthcare systems are reimbursed for doing that work. But we still have to do that work in partnership with community agencies and those that are with our patients, again, where they live and work every day. So what we've seen at Southcoast is an opportunity to impact care early on in the process. Maybe I could start with just a great example of what it means to reach out to patients and be impactful in their homes. We had a community health worker, one of our employees, who was visiting one of our patients. And this patient happened to be a woman in her 80s. She was suffering from chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or COPD. Mm-hmm. It was last summer. The temperature in her apartment was approaching 80 degrees. It was very humid outside. And this community health worker who was making a routine visit recognized that this patient was not going to do well very long in that environment. So she immediately got on the phone with her supervisor and asked for permission to go and buy an air conditioner. Her supervisor went to the petty cash, gave her $100 to go to Home Depot. He picked up an air conditioner, call that woman's son who met her at this person's apartment. They installed the air conditioner. And within an hour or so, this woman was now having relief. So a $100 air conditioner probably avoided a very expensive emergency department visit and potentially even an inpatient admission. And it kept this person from having to access the acute side of the system of care, kept her healthy in her home. And it's a $100 intervention for which no one will be reimbursed, but it made a huge difference of that one person.
Sure. That sort of highlights the fact that we need to think about some very low-tech interventions in order to address healthcare issues.
David, that is so true. You know, another great example of low tech, a patient of ours who is a diabetic, has some disabilities beyond just his diabetes, was having a great deal of difficulty managing his blood sugar and would end up in our emergency department frequently from having taken too much insulin. You know, he would go into a hypoglycemic crisis and end up being admitted. Now, over the course of time, over the course of a one-year period, he had almost 26 visits into our hospital. Another community health worker, recognizing that this could be avoided if we, you know, enabled him to have with him all the time something to eat or drink when he began to feel dizzy, simply purchased a fanny pack for him and then brought some juice boxes and candy bars that he could keep in his fanny pack. And he has not been in our emergency department with hypoglycemia since. So it's the low tech interventions. It's just understanding, you know, the challenges that our individual patients have in accessing care and being able to really implement a sound plan for self care that really make a difference. It's not a lot of expense, but it has a huge impact.
You've highlighted interventions made by a couple of astute observers in your workforce, and I'm wondering whether there's any institutionalized approach to training, to policy, as opposed to having these sort of one-off successes. How do you bottle that?
So what we try to do here at Southcoast Health is create a culture of empowerment for our employees. We want our employees to be able to make decisions, you know, where they could have the most impact, which is, you know, either at the patient's bedside here in our hospitals or at the patient's home at their kitchen table. So part of our training relates to making good clinical decisions for our patients, being able to recognize that an intervention, you know, can have a positive effect, you know, taking the initiative to intervene on that patient's behalf. And again, of course, communicating that with all members of the team so that we know what's happening with each one of our community.
So on the other end of the spectrum, I'd like to talk a little bit about innovation and digital technology in healthcare. In healthcare these days, the watchword seems to be innovation. And I'd like to ask sort of what does innovation mean to you? Is it all about technology or is it more than that? And what sorts of innovative technologies are you deploying in your system in order to help stay at the cutting edge? Do you see differences in type, differences in digital technologies in healthcare in a community hospital setting versus an academic or urban setting? Where do you fall on that spectrum and what sorts of tools are you using in your system?
Great question, David. At Southcoast Health, we believe that we need to constantly be seeking out new ways of approaching, you know, care challenges for our patients. Some of those interventions and some of those innovations are very low tech. Some of them are, of course, very high tech. There's really been an evolution within medicine and within healthcare delivery such that more and more of the care that patients need can be provided to those patients in an environment close to home. Being close to home allows for their family members to participate in their care, allows for patients to receive ongoing care and treatment without the dramatic expense of having to commute into town for that care. And we've recognized over time that we could provide the very best care close to home safely and cost effectively. So when we think about innovations, when we think about providing services to our patients, we've made some really substantial investments over time with regard to, for example, cardiovascular care, where we could perform transcatheter aortic valve replacements. We could place left atrial occlusion devices or the Watchman device for patients who are at risk for blood clots from chronic conditions like atrial fibrillation. We have surgical interventions in neurosurgery and, in our brain and spine program that allow for non-radiation imaging to help our neurosurgeons, properly place screws and plates in the spine. So we've made really substantial investments in technology that may be a little bit different from the average community hospital, but it's been to the benefit of our patients because their families are able to participate in their care and they've been able to receive care without having to spend time, in the car, driving to a different community that really just increases the cost of that care. So some of our investments include, advanced, medical record systems like Epic. We were the first community hospital in Massachusetts to install Epic as our electronic health record. And we did that after, a lot of exploration, a lot of consideration with regard to the power of information and how that would ultimately help us manage a population for which we were increasingly taking financial risk. We recognize that if we have enough data in about our patients, and we can compare that to data that Epic has available nationally, we would be able to figure out the most efficient, most efficacious way to provide care to patients and learn from that experience as time went on.
If you're just tuning in, this is Harlow on Healthcare, coming to you on Healthcare Now Radio. I'm David Harlow, and my guest today is Keith Hovan, President and CEO of Southcoast Health System in Massachusetts. Keith, we've been talking about innovation and technology in healthcare, and I know that you're participating these days in a digital health initiative at the state level. And I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit to that, what's going on there in Massachusetts, and whether and how that relates to your work at Southcoast.
So Massachusetts, as you know, David, really does have an innovation economy. And there are just incredible things happening here within the state in pharma, in genetics, in research, in information technology. And the governor, I think, was wise to convene really some of the best and the brightest throughout the state to come up with a plan that the administration could consider for implementation. And it's a group that is focusing on digital innovation and looking at ways that we can harness a lot of the great work that's happening here in Massachusetts, making Massachusetts, the Silicon Valley effectively of the Northeast, if those plans are implemented. So the Digital Health Council has been meeting really for the past 2 years and has recently finalized a report that will be presented to the governor. And elements of the recommendations that are in that report are actually already being implemented, and it's been a terrific initiative that has had participation from all areas within the healthcare IT space, from the provider space, the payers, companies that that produce information technology, companies that digest information technology. And I think the state will be well served if the recommendations that have come out of that report are implemented in full.
Yeah, I think it's an exciting time. I was fortunate enough to be at the opening of the simulation lab, or I'm not sure exactly what they call it, at at Worcester Polytechnic Institute, sort of under the aegis of this initiative, and really an opportunity to, as you say, sort of create a Silicon Valley of the East with a focus on healthcare.
We affectionately refer to that innovation center as a sandbox. Lots of people could get in there and play and test new ideas and new technologies. And
that's right. And with
it's fabulous.
Mm-hmm. And with my sort of privacy lawyer hat on, I'm always concerned about data breaches and personal health information getting out. And I understand part of the sandbox is the development of essentially some synthetic data that innovators and entrepreneurs can use in order to test out what they're working on, which is a terrific resource.
Absolutely.
So back to perhaps the front lines in your communities, I'm wondering if you could speak to the opioid crisis and how that has manifested itself in your communities and how South Coast has reacted to it.
Certainly. We have not been immune. Southeastern Massachusetts has not been immune to the scourge of the opioid crisis. And it has absolutely had a very deep impact on the communities that we serve. As we began to see an increase in substance use disorder in the patient populations that we're serving, we took several initiatives and began to implement a number of measures to try to reduce the need first for the actual prescribing of opioids. We know that the overprescription of opioids has had an effect of leading to the crisis that we currently find ourselves in. And in our emergency departments, as I look back over the period from 2016 to 2018, our emergency physicians were able to reduce their opioid prescription writing by nearly 70%. 70%. So how do we do that? We modified protocols. We modified order sets. We re-educated providers and in turn started re-educating patients about the proper use of pain medications and pain management. We sought new and novel ways of treating patients intraoperatively so they would have less pain in the postoperative period. We worked with the state so that EMTs and paramedics can give IV Tylenol, in an ambulance. The first introduction to many of our patients to a narcotic was in the ambulance when they had fallen and maybe injured an extremity. They were in pain, and EMTs could give morphine, but they couldn't give a non-narcotic like IV Tylenol. And now that's changed. We've really worked to change the way our providers think about addiction. And if we try to get patients into a system of care immediately when they present to our emergency department. And as I sit here today, I can tell you that we have approximately 75 of our emergency physicians who can write prescriptions for narcotic replacement therapy to bridge a patient to treatment. So they've been waived to prescribe buprenorphine and a medicine that's used to treat opioid use disorder. And we now in our South Coast Physicians Group have 10 providers who can write similar prescriptions and manage patients on an outpatient basis. But it really doesn't stop there. It's about connecting to community coalitions, community agencies, the folks who are out there being supportive of individuals who are challenged with opioid use disorder. And we do a lot of work through our community benefits grants. This past year, we provided approximately $50,000 to programs that are already established, but needed some additional support to continue to address this this crisis. So it's a multi-pronged, multifaceted approach that we've undertaken. We're starting to see an impact of those efforts, but I think it will take perseverance. It will take all of us working together at a state level to continue to bend that curve and to drive down those numbers.
And you've described really a comprehensive sort of approach and really a prevention as much as treatment, which is encouraging both in a clinical setting and beyond. Some health systems have taken the step of saying, we're not going to use opioids at all for pain management or otherwise. But I hear you stopping well short of that. You've talked about a significant reduction in their use, but not their wholesale elimination. Just curious sort of whether that was ever on the table in discussions with your clinical leaders and where that discussion may have led.
David, that's a discussion that our clinical leadership, I'm sure, has had, but not while I'm in the room. So I'd have a difficult time, giving you an honest, direct answer to that one. Mm-hmm.
Fair enough. So we've talked a lot about what I would call perhaps non-traditional investments in training, in approaches to care, whether using technologies, whether not using technologies, in order to improve care in your community health system. And I wanted to know, are there other sorts of investments that you'd like to touch on that you see as needed and or services that need to be offered in order to ensure that the communities you serve have the highest quality care available?
Absolutely. There's a number of other areas where we are making investments in the community. 95% of our employees come from the community that they serve. So this is a health system of neighbors caring for neighbors, friends caring for friends and family. And we have substantial concerns about, making sure we do everything to promote health and wellness. And, we know that health and wellness really begins with, having, access to good food. We work with our local farmers to bring food, fresh food and vegetables and, to our employees here at work. So, we have CSA days that take place at each one of our campuses. And the local food that isn't purchased by our employees is purchased by our health system. And then we donate that food to local food pantries to make sure that they have access to good, healthy food for the people that they're serving. We work with local agencies that wash the clothes of the homeless because we know that good hygiene is related to good health. So we help support efforts in simple things, simple interventions. But we also make investments in our people. And we know that if we're thinking about healthcare today, it's going to look different tomorrow. It's going to look different 5 years from now. And we need to make investments in understanding the future needs of the workforce. So we have terrific partnerships with Bristol Community College and the University of Massachusetts Dartmouth, where our future employees are being educated right now, and we know that the workforce of today is going to have an increased reliability on things like machine learning and artificial intelligence, and we need to incorporate those technologies into the work that we perform today. We work with those local educational facilities to try to get the next generation of healthcare worker interested in becoming a caregiver while they're still in school in the high schools. So, reaching out to the voc techs who are training nursing assistants and medical assistants who might end up working in our hospitals or our physician practices, and giving them a pathway to become registered nurses or advanced practice professionals over time. It's linking together with all of our community to really be impactful.
Well, Keith, you've alluded to the next thing that I wanted to ask you about to wrap up here, which is this. If you were to wake up tomorrow and find yourself 5 years in the future, what is one thing in healthcare that you would hope or expect to find has changed drastically?
Wow, what a great question. So if I were looking out 5 years from now, my hope is that we begin to recognize as a provider community that the things that are most impactful for patients are not necessarily the things that are most high tech or most expensive. It's bringing care, it's bringing services and promoting access to patients, you know, in their communities, in their homes. It's recognizing that, we need to be able to provide good, healthy meals, you know, to senior adults. It's recognizing that, you know, it starts with our kids and making sure that they have access to sports programs so that they can get out and walk and run and play in an environment where they feel safe, where parents know that they're being well cared for while they're at work. You know, one of the things that we've done, you know, is worked with, you know, our local communities in the two larger cities, and we've helped to build playgrounds. And you know, we'd rather make an investment in a playground than buy a table at an event. You know, if we could build a basketball court together, you know, with our community partners, and if the local police departments can make sure that they patrol and that it's safe for kids to be there, then we're gonna see reduced rates of obesity. We're gonna see reduced rates of diabetes over time. It's low cost intervention that I'm hopeful, you know, can be impactful in the future and make for healthier communities.
Well, that's an inspiring vision of the future in your communities. Thank you, Keith, for joining us today.
Thank you.
You have been listening to Harlow on Healthcare. Join us at healthcarenowradio.com. Let's continue the conversation on building the future of healthcare together at #HarlowOnHC. I'm David Harlow, keeping the fire going and holding a seat open for you. Until next time.